Greetings, fellow oldlings. Welcome back to Somewhere in the Scrolls Arena. Today's task at hand is to go over and raid the volcanic mountain known as Dagoth Ur. This is actually a post-gameplay recording, as you guys can probably tell. What happened was I made a video and I forgot to stop recording the video and shut the computer off. When I turned it back on again, the video was there, but yeah, I couldn't say the same about it being playable or processable. So yeah, my bad, but some experiences are harder learned than others. So this Dagoth Ur, the sacred entrance of the Dwarven Smiths into the Fire Mountain, Dagoth Ur stands before you. Magical runes glow in the red firelight, shimmering with heat. Sulfurous globes of steam escape from vents within the rock face of the opening. The final piece of the Staff of Chaos beckons. Alright, so here we are, Dagoth Ur, and as soon as I entered this dungeon, I sort of felt like, you know, I was impressed by the layout of this dungeon with all the different textures on the walls. You enter the Fire Mountain, Dagoth Ur. Around you, the air shimmers with heat. Even the stone floor is warm to the touch. So yeah, as soon as I entered this dungeon, I could, you know, feel like it was going to be a great raid, and I wasn't wrong. The first floor of this dungeon is actually quite good. The second floor, however, I can't really say the same about it. It was interesting, but not as interesting as the first floor itself. The first floor was a whole lot of fun. The second floor was more of a hardcore dungeon crawler, but yeah, the game is what it is. So anyway, this is basically a rip from Twitch. I screen recorded Twitch and edited it around a little to, you know, bring the content to you guys, because I completely lost the video recording from my original recording session, my original gaming session, and hence the game is also much more choppy. There's a lot of latency in my Twitch stream, and I'm thankful that this happened in a sense that I sort of got to know that there is a lot of latency when it comes to my Twitch, the way I stream on Twitch. Otherwise, I probably would have never known about that. But yeah, now that I know, I can probably, you know, toggle the settings around a little and make it faster, because the game, as you can already probably see, it is very, very laggy. So yeah, I sort of want to reduce that by as much as I can, and yeah, so that would be the next task at hand. This map again seems like it has got a lot of hidden doors here and there, and my main regret was not going for the door up top on the top left, the hidden door there, because that was the one door which could have led us to, you know, directly to the way to the next level. And curiously enough, this is actually the first dungeon where the way to the next level, where the objective is actually behind a locked door, which is incredibly difficult to both pick and bash open. So yeah, you probably need like 100 agility or something if you want to do that, but then again, my agility is 100, so yeah, I don't really know how it works. I tried pilfering this lock, it didn't open. I tried bashing it open, and it probably, you know, not probably, I mean, it finally opened after like a whole load of trying. So anyway, this is what the game is, and right now we are in a loot area of sorts. This here would be a loot room, more like a loot corridor, and up until this point I am going the right way. I probably divert, you know, I probably lose my way sometime much later towards the game. Not much later, actually. I lose it in a few moments here. Right now, what I'm talking about is how to loot in games like these. So what you see here is like an area where there is a huge concentration of loot, and my advice to beginners to this game would be, instead of going to, you know, small dungeons which exist inside a city and outside it, and going into the wilderness to loot, instead of doing that, the better thing to do would be to find a major dungeon and loot that instead. Like, find areas like these where there is a huge concentration of loot and the enemies aren't too overwhelming, and even if they are, you don't exactly need to fight them to get to the loot or get out. You can just, you know, run away from them and loot as much as you can and run and rinse and repeat. That way, what happens is you see all these things here. These are like so many magical items. Some of them may even be enchanted, and there's a high probability that you are actually going to get something that is pretty well enchanted, which is very, very expensive. And that probability, the probability of that guy's floating a lava there, I probably made a remark of it as far as I remember. But yeah, the probability of getting something that is very expensive is very less in, you know, these random dungeons. And again, I must apologize for the latency that this version of the rip has, because I mean, it's just how it got uploaded to Twitch. I can't really help it. A question which some of you might have in your mind, whether this is illegal for me to rip it off Twitch. Actually, it's not, because this is my content. And if any of you do it, yeah, that would be illegal. For me, it is completely legal. It's my content. I can do with it as I please. So, yeah. That being said, yeah, so basically, if you want to get rich quicker, this guy sort of scared me. And yeah, if you want to get rich quicker, don't go around looting minor dungeons. Those are shorter raids, they are easier, they probably won't require as many health potions or that much investment, but they also don't have much in terms of return of investment either. So if you really want to get rich quicker, then go for, you know, loot hotspots in these larger dungeons. And this is one of the areas where I get stuck for the first time, and it seems like Dagoth Ur has a lot of such areas where it's very easy for people to get stuck in, and I don't really know how that works, but it just does. So yeah, I mean, the platforms on these levels, in this dungeon, the pedestals in this dungeon aren't really all that well optimized. So, well, I guess it's just a part of the game. So right there, back there, I got stuck, and there's some more loot here. So definitely, if you find an area like this, you definitely should remember it, at least even if you don't mark it on the map. You remember it and keep visiting it again and again later on in the game. So yeah, I think I was saying another thing about how this video already has a voiceover, but another problem which I discovered is I speak very low. Now I would not be wrong if I label myself as a soft-spoken person, but I speak very, very low. And the game sounds in this game, the game volume in this game are just so damn loud. And I think I made a remark about that, about those 17 gold pieces that I got from that golem there. Anyway, the game volume is so loud, and I just speak so softly that yeah, I could barely hear anything. And that sort of factored into my decision to more or less just do a separate voiceover. In a normal recording, how I record is I record my voiceover in a separate channel and the game volumes in another channel, so that I can balance the, you know, so that I can basically apply filters and stuff on my normal channel, on my voice channel, and let the game and adjust the volume of the game channel, and vice versa, so that, you know, you guys can actually hear me over the sound of the game. But in this case, since it's again a Twitch rip, it's just all the volumes are mixed into one, they're merged into one, all the sounds, so I can't exactly isolate any of those audio streams and process them separately. So that's practically why I had to do this voiceover again, and well, here it is. Let's hope it's better. Let's hope I don't have to lower the volume of the game too far too much. I mean, I hope my voice in the game itself will not interfere much with the voiceover that I'm recording right now as I'm editing this game. But yeah, I also like I don't know, for some reason I just really like the way that this level is laid out. You can see the roots hanging from the ceiling, and you can see all these I don't know whether they're roots, but they are. These walls are also textured, and I really like how they're textured. So, I mean, I had a lot of fun exploring the first floor of the dungeon. The second floor, not so much, but then again, we'll be getting to that in a later video, which will probably be releasing, should be releasing 2 days after this. But, yeah. So right now I'm lost, I'm still trying to figure my way out, and while I do figure my way out, almost at the end of exploring this entire floor of the dungeon, I actually have to thank this guy, because this guy sort of more or less showed me that there was a hidden door there. But anyway, as I was saying, what was I saying again? Yeah, I mean, this floor of the dungeon wasn't as difficult as the Crypt of Hearts was. This was actually much more pleasurable to cruise around in and be like a crusader or a marauder or whatever else you would like to term it. But yeah, and again, I must deeply apologize for the laggy nature of the game. I mean, I don't really know how to set up a Twitch account or a stream, and apparently there's a lot that goes into it. Even an issue about transcoding, because Twitch does not change the encoding of your stream to suit other people. I don't know why they do that, but they just do that. So I expected it to be much better. I might start streaming on YouTube, but then again, I more or less want my streams on YouTube to be much more. How do I put this? More natural. So, yeah. Not more natural, actually. Well, I'll get to that in just a moment. This is the point where I am super confused about what just happened. I never realized that I pressed the inventory key, and I mean, I'm unable to move, and my health is at zero. And I'm thinking to myself, wait, did I just die? And it wasn't a long time before I figured out that I didn't, but the time that, but for the duration that I did, that it did take me to figure it out, it was actually quite a bit of a hassle, if you will. So yeah, I was actually genuinely concerned there for a moment. Sorry, I had to drink some water there. Water. Brits. Anyway. And here I am checking out the map and just trying to ascertain how much of the map I have actually discovered by this point in time. And to be honest, this, it really isn't that difficult a level, and this really isn't that frustrating a level, as I've probably covered multiple times thus far. And this is why you should really pop in potions of resist fire. I don't know if you noticed that or not, but as soon as I jumped in the lava, I did not lose a single bit of health. That's all because of the potion of resist fire. I never realized this before, but I do realize this now, and yeah, I mean, this playthrough sort of helped me realize that. So, potions of resist fire, they not only save you against fire damage, they also keep you from, well, burning to death when you fall in lava. You can practically swim in lava if you've got a potion of resist fire, and we are going to be exploiting that quite a lot in the second level of the dungeon. Speaking of the second level, that's where things go back to normal. I finished the first level and I shut down the computer. Not on purpose, actually. It was more of a crash. The system crashed. I don't know why it's happening, but the system crashes whenever I'm streaming on Twitch and simultaneously using DocsBox to play the games. But yeah, that it just happens. But yeah, the system crashed, and but good news is from the second level onwards, you will get more natural recording. So yes, talking about natural recordings, the thing is, see, the thing about Twitch is it has got multiple overlays, and you more or less need those overlays if you're planning to use your Twitch account to, you know, interact with the with your followers, with your viewers while you're streaming. And yeah, it's that's good for them, but what I want for YouTube is a very, very minimalistic UI. There's a reason that I don't actually put my face cam on YouTube, because I don't want it interfering with the gameplay. My voiceover, it's a voiceover, it doesn't get in the way of the game, it just adds value. But a face cam, stuff like that, yeah, I don't exactly want to put that into, you know, onto YouTube for the sake of, how do I put this? To keep things clean, basically. I don't want them, I don't want any intrusive UI polluting the screen. And the second thing is, this, I forgot what the second thing was, so yeah, I might remember that later on. But yeah, oh yeah, high quality content. So basically, I trim out a lot of the video. Like, for example, this recording footage itself was, when I recorded it, it was around 58 minutes long, and I have cut out a few bits here and there just to make it shorter. And yeah, I mean, so right now it's around 32 minutes long or something, but yeah. So that's another thing which I really want to do. I mean, on YouTube I want to keep my content comparatively higher quality. I mean, I get it, if you're streaming, you're basically showing the unfiltered content, there are people who are watching you play, but yeah, I don't exactly want to make stuff like that for YouTube. So for example, there's a cut right here, and this tunnel right here, this actually leads us to one of the loot rooms. But here's the catch: if you are not a wizard or, you know, a spellcaster who has an area of effect spell, where the area of effect or of effect is the space around you, a spell that surrounds you like Firestorm, then yeah, you're going to have a very difficult time accessing the area, because there is a homunculus right there which basically comes over onto your head and sits there. Now, the way this game is designed is that you cannot look up or down to attack, you can only look around you. And that actually leads me to say two things about the game, but first off, let's just get this out of the way. Since this thing is on your head, you really need some AoE spell. If there's a creature in the trenches, like these, in the caverns, in the crevices, or there's a creature on top of you, they can attack you, but you cannot attack them for the life of you. And yeah, so if you don't have an AoE spell, this is a treasure room. If you don't have an AoE spell, then the only thing which you can, a defensive AoE spell at that, the only thing which you can hope to do is keep reloading and make sure that the creature isn't there the next time you come around, or B, just you know, back away, unless it's some place that visiting which is imperative, in which you only have one option: keep reloading and hope that the creature doesn't block you. And number two, this sort of gives me a little bit of insight about how this game was designed. This is actually a two-dimensional game. This is by no means a 3D game. This does not use 3D models. It's a pseudo 3D game. It is completely built in a two-dimensional atmosphere meant to imitate a three-dimensional game. And yeah, so here's another cut here. So we're entering a different crevice. So what I think they did was they built a dungeon, and well, they saw more or less just visited each and every part of the dungeon. For example, there are the scene changes with each step you take. So they basically visited each step of the dungeon, and yeah, they clicked pictures of what it would look like throughout the dungeon. This place is a kill room, you will understand why shortly. So yeah, just look at that. This Yeah, there's an ambush. Every time you head into that room, there's an ambush. This time around, what I will do is I will try to play Elder Scrolls Arena like this Call of Duty, a first-person shooter of sorts, and just take cover behind pillars. Let them come over to me, and yeah, then slash them. I will not be exposing myself to them, and I will not let them kill me with their ranged attacks. So that's. I mean, I guess that's just one of the ways to play this game, but yeah, anyway, so what I think they did is they practically took pictures of how things are from every single angle, and now I may be wrong here, of course, but and they basically hard-coded it all, programmed it all. I mean, yeah, that sounds a little difficult to do, but then again, given the technology of that time, I highly doubt that something else was possible. If any of you know how things were made in this game, then I would highly encourage you to tell me about it, because I'm really genuinely curious about how this game was developed. I mean, right now all the files are like DOSBox files, and I don't even know the encoding. And here I was super pissed about going through all of that. I practically died like 4 or 5 times to get this, clear this room, and I did all of that for just one gold and an amulet. So yeah, I was a little pissed about that. But anyway, yeah, so if any of you guys know how this game was developed, do let me know, because I can't exactly, take a look at any of the source code. It's just, I think it's written binary or assembled in binary or something. It may be done in C, but I've got no way of knowing, because all the files are encrypted and I can't exactly open them. So, well, that being said, yeah, moving on. The next place we were about to go, you know what, I'll just shut up until we actually get there. So, So we decided to check out the place that's just adjacent to this. There's another place where these tunnels go to, and yeah, so we're currently headed there, and it's a room full of lava, but there isn't any sort of ambush there, and at the end of the room, you will be rewarded with a lot of treasure. But here's the catch: you cannot pick any of the treasure up. So, you the shadow thing moving there, which you can see moving there, that's actually a fire demon, and you have to defeat that fire demon in order to access the treasure. Actually, you don't. You can just run past him, but the ranged attack would probably kill you before you have a chance to save your own soul. So, yeah. So, drop down, engage the fire demon as soon as possible, who's literally standing on lava, but it isn't effective because he's a fire demon. And yeah, I consumed the wrong potion there. I meant to consume a potion of heal true, but I consumed a potion of resist fire. It did sort of help anyway, so yeah. Moving on, there's a door on the opposite end of. There's a hidden door right here, yeah. So, there's a hidden door right there. And there's a platform which you can use to more or less like get to the treasure room, but because of a bug, I don't know whether this is a bug or this was something intentionally done by the devs, you keep floating in the air, as you will see now. So I jump up, I keep following the road any moment now. Yeah, I'm still gonna check out the map for a bit. So it's in the extreme northwest corner, and yeah. So yeah, here is the treasure room. As you can see, there's already some gold down there. But woe be it, you cannot pick any of that up. I don't know whether this was a bug or this is something that the developers did intentionally, but you cannot pick up any of that gold. And I'm probably just cursing the game right now. And yeah, that's just one of the things. But I will show you how to pick up the gold. You are going to need pass wall. You need like a spell of pass wall. Destroy the walls near this place. And yeah, now you can access this place freely without any troubles. So I'm just going to destroy this extra wall. And for me, fortunately, I've got the Dwarven Tower Shield of Passfall. If you don't, you really need Passfall to get to all of this treasure. And if you like a spellcaster, you should have the pass wall spell. You can like climb back up normally, there's no problem. But once if you try to approach it from on top of the ledge, yeah, good luck, you can't drop down. I don't know whether it is a bug, it looks like a bug, but yeah, that's what it is. If you want the treasure, you need pass wall. And I'm just looking at my stats right now, and they all seem pretty normal, they all seem all correct. No issue with the stats there. And yeah, I think the game is having different sorts of bugs which does not involve the stats of my characters now. So yeah, that's I would say it's a good sign. Now where do I decide to go? I probably decide to take the path right on the pool, yeah, as I did just highlight on the map. And that is one of the ways which you can take to reach the objective. So here we go. If there is, I would be pissed. And I'm stuck again in the wall. And I am frustrated at this point. I think I cursed quite loudly about, you know, how this game needs to get it in line, or, you know, something along the lines of explicative this game and stuff like that. But yeah, I mean, you just walk and turn around a corner and there are two wraiths standing there who insta-kill you with a triple kill attack, a triple hit fireball attack, and that's just part of the game. It's just normally how the game is played, and well, there's no other excuse to it, honestly. But yeah. Oh, so wait, I guess, yeah, I did. So yeah, so it's right there in the northwest corner. That's where the, you know, like, actually not the northwest corner, the west corner was where the treasure was, the secret treasure was, the potion of fire resistance, resist fire, saving me again there. And yeah, the treasure room with all the treasure which you can't pick up is in the west corner. The objective is actually in the northwest corner. It's like a straight beeline straight from the entrance. A wraith just shot fireballs at me and disappeared out of nowhere, giving no explanations whatsoever. Well, that's just what the game is, so not complaining. And I was super glad that these two hellhounds actually came over to me to melee me, because this chamber looks to be some sort of crypt. Because otherwise I would have, you know, been super pissed if they had killed me with the ranged attacks. And there's actually a vampire right behind this crypt, and right now I'm wondering whether or not I should take this vampire on. Because, well, it's a vampire for, you know, I mean, it's a vampire, so I'm not exactly too eager to take this on. So, what happened last time when I took on a vampire was, it took a long time to die and I had to consume a lot of potions of healing. That was because my agility was already suffering because of the bug. It's not exactly the same this time around, and for some reason the vampire is warping through the platform and is basically standing on the outside. It's attacking, it's... Now that I look at the pause frame, it is actually attacking me. But yeah, it's curious to see a vampire swinging his sword when he can just, you know, sink his teeth in me and give me diseases. But at this point, I use the same... I don't think I've mentioned this before, this is the first time that I'm mentioning it. But once you kill people who cannot be killed, like vampires and trolls, what you need to do is, if you want to get their XP, you need to camp for 0 hours. The time doesn't pass, it doesn't care whether there are enemies around or not. You can camp and it just literally takes all the enemies, all the bodies away from the game. So if a vampire is in its recovery mode, since it can never be killed if it's in its recovery mode, you can like immediately farm all your XP. Do this for vampires, do this for trolls, do this for licks, leashes, I don't know how you pronounce that, I just encountered this thing for the first time in the second level of the game, which you will probably get to see that in the next video or the next video, because the second level is a long one. It's more or less like labyrinthian, where you have to collect multiple keys in order to progress. But yeah, if you ever face a vampire or anything of that sort, you really need to just rest for 0 hours. As soon as you have them down, as soon as you have all of them down, just rest for 0 hours, and that is the only way you can farm any XP. Otherwise the game just, you know, it won't give you an XP. You can run away, you can die, they might die, they might not die, but the game will not be giving you an XP for your kills. So no matter how many times you defeat them, unless and until you use this little trick. So you're basically losing out on a lot of XP, especially considering the fact that, you know, many of the high level creatures such as fire demons and wraiths and a lot of these, they don't really die, they just sort of randomly vanish off into space. And yeah, that's just something that you need to be mindful of, something that you need to do in order to progress through the game. So yeah, make sure that you rest for 0 hours and gain some XP. This probably isn't a bug. I mean, this might be a bug, or it's probably just this, something that the developers neglected to, you know, implement in their game, but they forgot to implement it in the game. But yeah, that's just the way it works. There's a learning curve to this game. It's an old game, and that's how you do it. And this is the door to the, you know, which the portal to the next floor, which I cannot open for the life of me. And I keep bashing it, and I keep bashing it, and I keep pilfering it until it actually finally opens, as it does now. So yeah, and with that, thanks for watching. I will catch you later. Until next time, take care. Farewell, fellow Earthlings.